This call is now being recorded.
Okay, I'll start the class now. So, the today's topic is heart failure and valvular heart diseases. Okay. So, I told you yesterday what is the definition of heart failure. Heart failure means inability of the heart to pump the blood, which is at the requirement of the body. Whatever is the body's requirement, that much heart has to pump. If it is not able to meet this demand, then we call it as heart failure. And these are the few things you should know. That is stroke. This is stroke volume. What is stroke volume, Akash?
So the amount of blood that is pumped by the ventricle per contraction.
Per contraction or systole. Fine. That is called as stroke volume. You measure it with this. Okay. End diastolic volume minus end systolic volume. This is a formula to measure it. Okay. What is cardiac output, Suti? Stroke volume multiplied by the heart rate. Okay. That is amount of the blood that is ejected during 1 minute. Okay. That is cardiac output. For 1 minute, how much blood is ejected from the heart, that we call it as cardiac output. These things are self-explanatory. That is end diastolic volume and end systolic volume. Welcome, Roshan. These things are self-explanatory. That is end diastolic volume and end systolic volume. These are self-explanatory. That is at the end of the diastole, what is amount of blood that is end diastolic, systolic, same. What is ejection fraction?
The amount of fraction stroke of volume, end diastolic volume that is ejected.
Yeah. Stroke volume fraction by of the blood. Yeah. Fraction of the blood that is ejected. Fraction of what? End diastolic volume. In express in percentage. That is ejection fraction. Okay. Because if there is 100 ml of blood at the end diastolic volume, if that is only 60%, 60 ml is ejected. Okay. That means 60%. Similar. Okay. That's what is. And it is given by this formula. That is end diastolic minus end systolic volume, which actually means stroke volume divided by end diastolic volume. Okay. I'm going a bit faster. So we classify heart failure in multiple ways, right versus left. I told you why. Because we try to classify multiple ways is because to understand better. So right heart failure means the signs of right heart failure will be there, left heart failure. So right heart means right ventricle, right atrium here, left means left side. Okay. So similarly, high output failure, low output failure. So high output failure is hyperdynamic circulation. Okay. Low output failure means decreased circulation due to loss of contraction of the heart or good pericardial diseases, whatever is the cause for decreased output. That is low output failure. So heart failure with a reduced ejection fraction, preserved ejection fraction. So ejection fraction, as I said, it is from normal is 50 to 70%. Yes. Okay. If this is less than 50, to call it as reduced ejection fraction, definition is less than 40%. Okay.
Yes, sir.
By definition, normal ejection fraction is this much. Okay. 50 to 70. But call it as ejection fraction of reduced heart failure. This one, but for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, it is should be less than 40%. You should know this. In preserved, it will be more than 40%. If there are signs of heart failure with the preserved ejection fraction more than this 40%, then we call it as heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Okay. Then we'll go pathophysiology of heart failure. So left-sided heart failure means signs will be in the lungs. Right-sided heart failure means the signs in the rest of the system like JVP, tender hepatomegaly, pedal edema. Okay. These are the signs. So left-sided heart failure, LVS3, tachycardia, pulmonary congestion, these are signs. Yesterday I explained to you what is the cause for tachycardia. Smriti.
Sympathetic stimulation.
Yeah, sympathetic stimulation secondary to meet the required cardiac output.
Yes, sir.
Stroke volume will be less. By increasing heart rate, cardiac output will be met. That's the reason for tachycardia. Pulmonary venous congestion I discussed. In fact, I told you the difference between pulmonary arterial hypertension. What is pulmonary venous congestion and pulmonary hypertension? Okay, these two things. I explained. NYHA, we discussed yesterday. I'm going faster. You know these things, na?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Loud P2 because of pulmonary arterial hypertension. Okay. NYHA means here class 1, class 2, class 3, class 4. So, for simple understanding, class 1 means breathlessness for unaccustomed work. So, it varies from person to person. If the person is a manual labor, for him, unaccustomed work is different. For me, it is unaccustomed is different. A manual labor can lift about 50 kgs comfortably and walk for 100 meters. But for me, it may not be. And this person, 50 plus, if he gets breathless, it is class 1. And if for 50 kgs walk, weight walk, if he gets breathless, it is class 2. And for toilet going and all that, it is class 3 breathless. This is at rest. So we simply call it as unaccustomed work, accustomed work, then the routine work, then rest. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Easy to remember. So, just like say, I told you about bat wing sign. You see, can see bat wing there?
Yes, sir.
This bat wing, they can keep it just like say. And one more thing you should know that in heart failure, hold on a minute. Somebody is early. So Dr. Hosangadi is joining. Welcome, Dr. Hosangadi. Dr. Hosangadi, welcome.
Hi.
Okay. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening, everybody.
Hold on. So, hold on a second. Okay. So I told about battering sign. I'll come to this X-ray. In heart failure, we get a congestion which is more predominant in the hilum. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And peripheries are not congested. They're more free. Okay. That's what a sign of heart failure. Unlike in non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, you know what is I told you, yesterday, ARDS and all that. The congestion is not limited to the hilum. It can be anywhere outside also. That's how we try to differentiate the cardiogenic from non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Yesterday, I asked you to read about pulmonary capillary blood pressure. Did you read it?
Yes, sir.
Now what is it?
Sir, normal is up to 10, sir.
Okay. If it is enough for ARDS patients, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will be normal. In pulmonary cardiogenic pulmonary edema, it will be more. Usually, we do this to test and try to differentiate. But you should know that. It is rarely examined these days. For MCQ, you should know and read more about pulmonary capillary blood pressure. They can ask some questions on that. So I told you about the curly A lines from periphery up to the hilum. Curly B lines, they are limited to the C here. The curly A lines are coming up to the hilum here, up to the hilum. You can see. And these, which are here, which are horizontal here. Horizontal, they are curly B lines. These are A, these are B, and these reticular pattern, what you see here. These are C lines. Okay. They can ask you. You should at least know. A means up to the hilum. B means only from here, the midway on the straight lines. The reticular pattern here is what?
C.
The same thing. Cephalization. You can see cephalization nicely here. Venous congestion going up to the predominant veins will become more prominent in the upper part of the lobe compared to the lower part. You can see here, this X-ray, is also called Mustache sign or Colonel Mustache sign, okay?
Yes, sir.
I'm going, okay, right heart failure. So, raise JVP, this, okay? I'll come here. So, this is JVP 45 degrees, You have to keep measure from the sternum here. You have to measure these things we have discussed yesterday. And internal jugular vein you should use, not external jugular vein. And internal jugular vein lies behind the sternocleidomastoid.
Okay.
Yeah, you should know that. You tell me what is the cause for A wave?
It
contraction. X descent. X descent. What is the cause for X descent?
Atrial relaxation.
Sir, tricuspid bulging.
Okay.
After tricuspid bulging, that is movement, open up the tricuspid valve, then filling of the ventricles.
Yeah, it is basically atrial relaxation. The fall is because of that. And C wave is in fact, what is it due to? When atrial diastole, you can start here. This is a systole and this is diastole. And when the ST diastole starts, the C wave will close in the midway of this. Okay. C wave is due to ventricular contraction. Tricuspid wall. C wave, we should say it is because of closure of the tricuspid wall and bulging into the right atrium. That is the cause of C wave. And this C wave is truly a interruption in the X descent. Some people call this X prime and this call as X. You remember this, okay? And this is atrial relaxation. Now, this is what is the cause for V wave? The size of the heart is less during this time because both the ventricles are contracting. Okay, inside the pericardial sac, there will be a lot of space left. So the atria will get more space to expand.
Yes, sir.
So the tricuspid wall also will descend down. So because of that, Hello? Hold on. So, because of that, you will get a V wave and the Y descent is ventricular filling.
Yes, sir.
MR atrial emptying into the because of opening of tricuspid wall. So, that's about JVP. We'll go to diuretics. So these drugs I have discussed. Welcome. What are the diuretics we used in heart failure?
Prosamide, sir.
Better called loop diuretics.
We use
loop diuretics for heart failure. And I told you why we use ACE inhibitors. ACE inhibitors in heart failure.
To reduce the afterload.
Afterload.
And vasodilation.
And?
Vasodilation.
Yeah, this afterload reduction is with the vasodilation. Okay. If you reduce, you do vasodilation, it will reduce the afterload. That's what happens. And why we use beta blockers? I told you yesterday.
Heart rate, sir.
Yeah, unnecessary excessive heart rate is bad for heart. So, we should reduce it with the beta blockers. Which are the beta blockers are used for heart failure?
Metoprolol, bisoprolol, carbidol.
Yeah, you told. Bisoprolol, metoprolol and carbidol are used. And why we use aldosterone antagonist?
Sir, prevention of the ventricular remodeling, sir.
That is due to hyperaldosterone that will have benefit there. And there is secondary aldosteronism will be there in heart failure. By giving these drugs, this hyperaldosteronism will be checked. That's why we use. And what are nephrolysin inhibitors?
Sacubitril.
Okay. Nephrolysin inhibitors are newer drugs which are compared better with this ACE inhibitors. In fact, we use them with a combination of ARBs. What are the indications of ARBs in presence of heart failure?
Sir, if a dry cough in the ACE inhibitor is
caused. Patient cannot tolerate ACE.
What?
Patient cannot tolerate ACE inhibitors.
If they don't tolerate ACE inhibitors, then we use ARBs. Otherwise, ACE inhibitors are preferred over ARBs. Okay. Now, aldosterone antagonist, these are the two. And what is the advantage of this drug, Eplerenone, over Spironolactone?
More selective.
Gynecomastia is a complication of Spironolactone. Huh? Eplerenone, its incidence is less. Okay?
Yes, sir.
In males, if you prescribe Spironolactone, if they develop gynecomastia, we give them Eplerenone. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Huh? You got it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Huh? And I told you what is CRT. What is CRT?
Sir, cardiac resynchronization therapy.
Resynchronization therapy. Because heart has to contract in a systematic fashion.
Systemic.
Will not give effective systole or effective ejection of the blood. So by using this device, we make it to contract systematically. So the blood flows out. That is the purpose of CRT. Okay. And why? What is ICD?
Defibrillator.
Yeah, you have seen defibrillator in the ward, huh?
Yes, sir. External defibrillator.
Patients of heart failure, they are prone for sudden cardiac death. That is due to VF
ventricular
and ICD. They are more prone for this. Okay.
Yes, sir.
That is one of the commonest cause of death in heart failure, especially if the LV is dilated. Systolic heart failure is there, na? Heart failure is reduced ejection fraction. Those patients are prone for intracardiac death. So such patients, we to prevent this, we because if there is a VF happens, we have hardly time. If it happens outside the hospital, by the time patient reaches the doctor, it will die. Correct?
Yes, sir.
In 3 minutes, the brain will be dead. If there is a circulation, if it is stopped, within 3 minutes, brain dead. You can imagine the need of urgency. Got it? If VF happens, if it doesn't revert back to sinus rhythm within 3 minutes, or circulation, if it is not established within 3 minutes, or if the delayed, if it is much delayed, the patient may die. Okay.
To yes, over sir.
That, we give suddenly to defibrillate, DC shock. To give DC shock, we place a device, defibrillator, inside the body itself. It will be a very small device. You can hold it within your palm. You will do less than like. You have seen pacemakers?
Yes, sir.
Pacemaker, artificial pacemaker, not this one. Normal pacemaker, that is SA node. I'm not asking about that.
Yes, sir. Artificial, sir.
You see the, you Google it. Pacemakers, you can see that image. It will be, you can hold in very small, it will be inside the hand. It's a very small device. It is placed below the skin.
Yes.
And we'll place the leads inside the heart. It will give a shock if the patient develops these arrhythmias. Okay. And we try, with this, we'll reduce the sudden cardiac death. Okay. These are the drugs, milrenone, dobutamine. Dopamine are used for acute phase, not in outside the hospital. These drugs, they are predominantly we discuss with the chronic phase. So we'll go to mitral stenosis. Causes for mitral stenosis, everybody knows it is rheumatic heart fever, rheumatic fever. And it can be congenital minus mitral stenosis very rarely. And old age, without rheumatic heart failure, patient can develop mitral stenosis by
calcification.
Yeah. So the what is the commonest of all to undergo calcification in the old age?
Sir, mitral.
Aortic stenosis is one. Actually, after rheumatic heart disease, commonest cause for AS is this only. Calcific AS. Okay.
Yes,
in old age people, the aging will produce calcification of the aortic wall and leads to aortic stenosis. That is a common cause for aortic stenosis in old age. Okay. With or without bicuspid wall. What is bicuspid wall?
Mitral valve without.
How many cusps are there in aorta? Normally? Three.
Three, sir.
There are three. due to some congenital anomaly, they can have only two cusps. Two will be there. Only they will be there. And these patients, we can develop calcific AS. They can develop much more common compared to the person who has got normal wall. And this calcific AS in these people occurs early, around the age of 40. So if you get a question, 40 year old male presents with signs of AS with click, ejection click in a tick area, then you should tick bicuspid wall.
Yes, sir.
At the same time, if you get a calcific AS later, in old age, much more old age, like 70 years or 80 years, it will be usually a normal wall only going for calcific later stage. Okay. This calcific aortic disease can also have AR, which is less common. But got it? They have these questions. Bicuspid wall and tricuspid wall, these things they can ask you. So there is a in mitral stenosis and mitral regurgitation. Both of them will increase blood inside the left atrium. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
In mitral stenosis, because there is a blockage here, the blood flow into the left ventricle is
decreased.
In mitral regurgitation, whatever has gone out, then it will come back. That is easily more. But the difference here is, in the mitral stenosis, mitral stenosis, pressure will be more.
Yes,
in sir. Initial stages, sir, there is just dilatation without increase in pressure.
Yes, sir.
This one is important for atrial fibrillation. Yes, so, sir. If the patients of mitral stenosis are more more frequently develop AF because there is a high pressure inside the left atrium. This will cause fibrosis there. More fibrosis. Okay. That's the reason mitral stenosis patients develop AF more frequently than patients of mitral regurgitation.
Yes, sir.
Basically, pressure game. In mitral regurgitation, there is a dilatation without pressure increase. In mitral stenosis, there is a dilatation with pressure increase. And in fact, a mitral regurgitation patient tolerate mitral regurgitation for longer time. Longer time. Because there is no increase in pressure, they don't develop this pulmonary venous congestion. That early, I mean. They develop it later, usually when the left ventricle starts failing. Because of hypodynamic thing. It has pumped a lot of blood, here and out, both, dual work. Later on, LV also starts failing. Critical failure also will add up. Then it is a stage the pressure starts increasing here. And they may start developing this pulmonary venous congestion and your signs of pulmonary edema and all this later.
Yes, sir.
Okay. That is some sort of a difference between MS and MR. Clinical things I had told you. S3 versus opening snap. Those things you should know.
Yes.
You know these things, S3. S3 is where? Here, S3? In a mitral regurgitation, you hear. Here, we don't get S3, we get opening snap here.
Opening snap.
Diastolic events, this is low pitched, this is high pitched. Yeah, you should know that. Okay, now we'll go to RA and RV, dilatation. That happens because of AH. Okay.
Yes, pulmonary artery hypertension.
Yeah, pulmonary hypertension happens. Now we'll go clinical findings. These things we have discussed, and this one I wanted to discuss. What is this? Loud heart sound will be there. In a patient with MS, there is loud heart sound. First heart sound, you know that. So when you don't get loud of first heart sound, if there is a calcification,
yes, sir.
The calcification of the mitral wall, the patient's loudness of the heart sound will reduce. Okay. When the opening disappears. Same. If there's a calcification, the opening snap disappears. I told you, what is opening snap? So it is opening of the mitral reflex during diastole. Before the
yes, sir,
it opens snap, as there is a high pressure in the left atrium, it will open with force.
Forcefully open, sir.
Forceful opening will be there. That will produce a sound. So, if the wall leaflets of the mitral apparatus have become calcified, then there is no sound such production. Okay. And they may ask you this question. A2OS duration and its relation to severity of the AS, MS. If A2 and OS duration is less, MS is more
severe.
Okay. You should know. They will ask these questions. That's why I'm asking you to focus. A2, that is, A2 means? It's not A2. Sorry. This one. Just scribble this. It's S1. I wrongly written it here.
Yes.
S1, OS, duration. Okay. Typing mistake. Okay. S1, OS duration. This is the first start zone. This A2 ray, correct?
Sir, S2, sir.
S2
only. Correct. And this S2 only. S2 means I'm talking A2 na. Why I'm talking A2? A2 is a, this is correct. Typing is correct. Name.
Yes,
this is a first art sound. There is a second art sound. Has got two components. Okay. Again, first art sound come later.
It's a A2. 1 minute. It's a, what you are telling
A2
me right.
Is the aortic component of second art sound. P2 is pulmonary component of second heart sound. So you can, if you are calling it as S2, fine. S2 and opening snap. This is a MDM later followed. A2, this duration between these two. This duration time, if it is less, it is severe. Okay.
Sure, sir.
A2 OS duration, if it is less, we call it as the severity of the MS is more. Okay. The signs of RVH. What are the signs of RVH you get? How do you say the RVH is there clinically? Left parasternal heave. Okay. On the sternum left, what is left parasternal heave? You can feel the pulsations with lifting of the hand. Okay. That is how we look for RVH. Even the left atrial enlargement also can add up to the RVH. Okay, you should know that. So you can feel that on the left parasternal area. Because right, the heart is here. The bone will be somewhere here. You can feel this pulsation here. Okay. This is the mandibulum sternum. This is the boundary of the heart. So you can feel the pulsations here. That is left parasternal heave. On the right side, what do you get? If it comes on the right side, that is RA enlargement will come here on the right side. Okay, left side. And the mitral, this is a left atrium is behind here, like this. Okay, it is. I told you it is a posterior most structure. This is the landmark of right atrium. This is the landmark of left atrium. You are hearing me?
Yes, sir.
This is the landmark of, this LV may not be seen sometimes because RV may come up till here. I want to show you, it comes here LV. This is RV. Okay. This is how anatomical heart is. Now, this is the X-ray. That's what I was showing here. You can see here double atrial shadow. This is LA, left atrium. And this is the border of RA.
RA, right atrium.
And what is this ring? Can you see some ring here? What is
yes,
it?
Sir.
And you can see something here. You can see this something has been put here. What is this? Now, if they give this X-ray to you, what do you think? There are some things here. Do you think they're natural or unnatural things? What is this? Akash, have you seen such things? Are they inside the body or outside the body, first thing?
Sir, outside the body, sir.
No, man, this patient has undergone mitral, wall replacement. Okay. And this is the sternum. They cut open the sternum. Surgery, na? They cut open the sternum. And this for the what sternum means, the vertically slit it. Vertically. And while closing it, they will tie it with the wires. It is forced surgical. Yes. Okay. And yes, what is mitral wall replacement? Is what is there? Is a ring seen? Here the mitral wall is. That is there. That's what you're seeing here. It is a patient of post MVR. This patient has undergone mitral wall replacement. Okay. And you are seeing this left atrium, sorry, okay, border. This you can call as double atrial shadow. Okay, 1, 2, there are two atria seen, double atrial shadow. You saw, you got it?
Yes sir.
When you see such rings, don't say it is a some shirt button or some hook or other, they'll be inside the body. They are wires kept to tight to the sternum. For heal, otherwise sternum won't heal, because they had to fix it. Now, what is this ECG? What are you seeing? Some heavy things here. Akash?
Yes, sir.
What is this? Okay, we'll come to that later. Now, down here, there is a long strip they have taken. Okay. You're seeing here. And duration, see here, this one, you just focus here. These are peaks of R wave. Okay. The duration, the interval between this and this and this are the same. These two are coming narrower. These two are coming bit far away. And this is much more far. Irregularly, it is changing. You can see. Sometimes it is wide, sometimes it is less wide. So there is a irregular
RR interval.
RR interval. What is the hallmark of irregular RR interval? Which arrhythmia you suspect?
Atrial fibrillation.
To get the irregular RR interval, what is that? Blindly, you should diagnose it. Don't break your head more. If you get irregular RR interval, beta wave dynamics, atrial fibrillation, don't break your head. Irregular means it should be irregular. There is something called a sinus arrhythmia and all that. Rule out that first before that. What is sinus arrhythmia?
Sir, due to variation of the intrathoracic pressure while breathing, there is variation.
There is a variation in the heart. But confirm that it is not sinus arrhythmia. And if it is really irregular, then it is AF. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And these are called fibrillatory waves.
Fibrillatory waves.
They are actual fibrillatory waves. This is the case of atrial fibrillation. Okay. And this is, look at this X-ray now. Now, when the heart rate is less, nobody usually misses them. Okay. Even if you just see the monitor, what is a monitor? What monitor I'm talking about? You are seeing, enter the ICU, intensive cardiac care.
Yes, sir.
They'll attach monitor to that, to the patient. There will be beats going on. In movies, they're shown. So,
yes, sir.
Even if you see the monitor, you will diagnose this without actually ECG. If the heart rate is less. What is the heart rate? How to calculate heart rate? Roshan?
Sir, for 300 by in regular interval, like sir, 300 by our number of RR interval in 30 small box, sir. 30 box.
300 by number of big box,
Yes, sir.
1500
by small box.
Okay, that's all. You have to count the CR, for example. Actually, in this case, it is RR interval, you have to take, they are difficult to calculate heart rate, but you can average them. So 1, 2, 3, 4, nearly 5 big squares. So 300 by 5 means 6. the 60, around 60, 60 to 70. Sometimes it is 70, sometimes 60. The range is that. Okay, here. Okay. But in this case, we'll come to next one. Here, there is a, if you are very focused, you can pick it up. Here it is a wide, whereas here it is narrow. Huh?
Yes, sir. Also.
Again, it is changing.
Irregular.
So, heart rate is very high. You are supposed to look into the quality ECG only. You may miss it. What is the calipers you use to measure heart rate? In your few, this one, school days, you used to use this caliper personal like this. There used to be calipers. You remember this? They'll be in the
layer. Oh, yes, sir. It's geometry box.
Geometry box, yeah. With that, you have to measure whether you keep one rod of this here, one here, take the size and go on checking, comparing. That is one thing. Otherwise, you have to take a paper, one paper, put that paper here, one paper, white paper, put that paper here, okay, and mark on the paper, mark upon the paper, 3 to 4 beats, like this. And then go, take this paper from here and move it to the rest, some other place, and try to see whether those beats are matching with it. That also you can do. If they are matching, the heart rate is regular. If not matching, heart rate is irregular. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Then what are the complications that you see? Say, mitral stenosis. There is a clot formation. There is a clot formation. You're seeing? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
You can see? Hold on. So, where? Okay. There could be, because in mitral stenosis, there is a stagnation of blood in the left atrium or left atrial appendage. Left atrial appendage. You know, it is just like a ear attached to the left atrium. Okay. Hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Left atrial appendage, there is a stagnation of blood. There is a formation of clot there. This formation of clot and embolize and produce cerebrovascular accidents or peripheral artery embolization. They may embolize to mesentery and cause ischemia. Many things can do. That is one of the complications of MS. They can develop this complication. And atrial fibrillation I discussed, and heart failure I discussed. Okay. Now, how do you treat diuretics? You know, decoction, why you give? To reduce the heart rate. If there is a AF, digoxin is helpful in presence of AF. Okay, in for MS patients, because left ventricle is not failed here. Okay, if you want to really increase the force of contraction with help of digoxin, left ventricle is failed. However, we give it to reduce the heart rate. So, other than digoxin, what all drugs you can use to reduce the heart rate or AF?
Beta blockers.
Good. Beta blockers you can use. Then even verapamil can be used. Okay. You can use.
Yes.
And why you should give anticoagulation? If there is a
bleeding.
What, Roshan?
To bleeding tendency, sir. To maybe.
Are if you give anticoagulation?
To prevent clot.
To prevent clot.
To prevent clot formation.
Because these patients are prone to develop left atrial clot, they can embolize and cause those problems. To prevent cerebrovascular accident, we give them anticoagulants. Okay. Treatment is percutaneous transmitral commissurotomy. Okay. Or if there is associated MR with MS, then PTMC will not be done. Patient will have to go for wall replacement surgery. That's the X-ray I showed you. That patient undergone wall replacement. If there is a your MS, then PTMC is possible. What is PTMC? I told you the full form just now. For cutaneous transmitral
Right.
Mitral commissurotomy. What are the commissures?
Sir, anterior and posterior.
Yeah, there are anterior and posterior because there are two leaflets here.
Yes.
Imagine this is one leaflet whole thing. This is one more leaflet whole thing. These are parts. This what is the angles are? This is a commissure here.
Yes.
What happens in MS is these two leaflets will get joint here like gum, with gum like thing, and there can be calcification formation later. Usually it will become more sticky and they'll join, thus the walls will not open. Okay, these are commissures. There are two commissures, because there are two leaflets, there are two commissures. These commissures will stick to each other. That is the reason we get MS. Now what we do in PTMC is we'll keep a balloon here across this opening and open it. So they'll split. Okay, they'll split. And again, walls will be able to open completely, and this orifice will increase in size. How we do is, so this is the heart.
Femoral vein.
Femoral vein, femoral vein. I'll go from femoral vein, go to inferior vena cava, then enter inferior vena cava, which opens into right atrium. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. This is RV. This is LV. This is LA. This is RA. Okay. From femoral vein, I'll go to inferior vena cava. From inferior vena cava, I'll go into the right atrium. Okay. And what I will do is we'll puncture here with the needle. In that, there will be tube. Inside tube only we'll do. We'll not open, cut open the patient. In that tube, now what I take, I'll puncture here. Puncture and take the balloon through that puncture and place it here across. And inflate it and open that commissures. This is what is percutaneous transmetal commissurotomy. Got it?
Yes, sir.
That's what they may ask you, PTMC. And PTMC is possible if there is only pure MS. If there is a more grade 2 MR plus, then PTMC is not advised. Because I may cure mitral stenosis, but wall replacement will not be cured. Better to go for mitral wall replacement. Okay. Now, something about the dynamic auscultation. What is dynamic auscultation? Okay, we'll talk, discuss about dynamic auscultation. Okay, preload. What is preload?
End dash.
Preload.
End diastolic volume.
What end diastolic volume? Yeah, end diastolic volume. Correct. Where? Before the, that is end. That is end diastolic volume. Correct. End diastolic, that is the volume of the blood before systole. That is end diastolic volume only. Preload is end diastolic volume. What is afterload?
Sir, egress is afterload?
That is the pressure against which the hardest to pump.
Yes, sir.
This is before contraction. Preload is before contraction. This is after contraction. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Which are the factors which will determine the preload? Now we'll come. Now there is HOCM, mitral wall prolapse. These are the questions they'll ask. You should know this table in brief. Okay. There is a hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy.
Yes, sir.
Then there's a mitral wall prolapse is there. Then we have aortic stenosis, MR is there, VSD and TR. MEP as a complication produces MR. Okay. So, is a HOCM, what sort of murmurs will get usually? Ejection systolic murmur.
Yes, sir.
Ejection systolic murmur. Otherwise, I'll put it as. Yes, yeah. Okay. In MEP, what you get? Late systolic murmur. Okay. AS, you'll get same. Ejection systolic murmur. We got ejection systolic murmur. MR, we get
pan systolic
murmur. we get usually pan-systolic murmur. Sometimes you can develop early systolic murmur. Okay. TR, we get usually pan-systolic murmur. Sometimes there can be early systolic if there is a PAH. But remember that if TR patients may develop early systolic murmur if there is associated PAH. Okay. Otherwise, they develop pan-systolic murmur. So, you repeat this. This is ESM. ESM, late systolic murmur, ESM, that means early systolic murmur. So, ejection systolic murmur I'm talking about. Here, pan-systolic murmur, this is pan-systolic murmur. So, all these are systolic murmurs. So, differentiate between the one another, this dynamic auscultation is there. So, dynamic auscultation depends upon these two factors. With the help of dynamics, whatever manuals you apply, you'll be affecting these things, preload and afterload. Okay. For example, Valsalva manual, what happens? You increase the
activity,
thoracic pressure in strain phase. There are phases of Valsalva manual. For all practical purposes, just imagine Valsalva manual means during the strain phase, the intrathoracic pressure is increased. So if the intrathoracic pressure is increased, so the blood flowing towards heart is reduced. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
So Valsalva manual during strain phase will reduce the preload. Standing, it will also reduce preload only. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Because gravity. Again, we'll come to squatting. But squatting, what happens? It will increase
preload,
afterload. You're giving a pressure out. You are giving a pressure. By squatting, you are increasing the pressure. So you will actually increase the afterload. Hand grip, similarly, these are isometric. This will increase the afterload. Add it. Now, if the preload increases, If the preload, we'll come to know first before that. If these two producers, what happens? Decrease the preload. If there is a decrease in preload, this Valsalva manual and standing will, if they decrease the preload, the murmurs of HOCM and murmurs of MVP, they will increase. Okay.
Yes.
I'll put it this way. Preload decrease. So if the preload decrease, that will increase the murmurs of HOC. I means increase. They'll ask this question. So if the preload decreases, the HOCM murmur and mitral prolapse murmur will increase. This is here. It is intensity. Here it is duration.
Yes, sir.
So preload actually decreases here. By doing this one, you are actually decreasing preload. So the murmurs are increasing here. These two, you focus these two now. Okay. They are increasing here. Now, by squatting and hand grip, what you are doing?
You're increasing afterload.
You are decreasing
preload.
Decreasing preload, increasing afterload, Okay. So by doing this squatting hand grip, you are increasing afterload. So by increasing afterload, the murmurs of HOCM and MEP will decrease. Got it? So in other words, you can put it, if the preload increases or afterload increases, the murmur, what happens? Decreases. Confused again? Hello?
Yes, sir. No.
See, Valsalva manual and standing will decrease preload. Squatting and hand grip will increase afterload. See, when these arrows are down, these arrows are up. So here, and when these arrows are up, this is down.
Yes, sir.
So, but these maneuvers will decrease the preload. These maneuvers will increase after load.
Yes, sir.
So if the preload and after load, if they are both of them are if you increase, you will get a decrease in these murmurs. If the preload and after load, if they go down, these murmurs will increase.
Yes, sir.
You need to remember this, this table alone will be very difficult for you. So I am trying to make a mnemonic like. So preload increased, murmurs will increase. Here actually by anti-squatting I'll call it as. If I do anti-squatting, actually you are reducing afterload. Then they'll increase now. So preload and afterload, if both of them if you reduce, the murmurs will increase. And preload and afterload, both of them need to increase, murmurs will decrease. It's the mnemonic. And these procedures, they are reversed to each other.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Problem is here. These two things are opposite to each other. So but these maneuvers will decrease preload. These maneuvers will increase preload. That's why that inverse thing, it will be again double inverse. It will become preload afterload. If they increase, the murmurs will decrease. Preload afterload. If they decrease, the murmurs will increase. This applies to these two conditions. They can ask you this in exams. Whereas these conditions, they are just opposite to that. These two. These two. Okay. This yes, you can get this slide. Focus on preload and afterload. You can remember it better. Mitral regurgitation, there is a tremendous big list. I really don't want to go into all that. Mitral prolapse, one thing you remember. Rupture of chorda tendine. What are chorda tendine that day I told you? What are chorda tendine?
Sir, inside the valve, sir, there is.
They are like three things attached to the valve leaflets and a papillary muscle.
Yes, sir.
This is a papillary muscle which is attached to the septum or free valve. Okay. There are at least two papillary muscles on the left side. These are chorda tendine. These strings, there. Okay. If they get ruptured, then this valve will start floating here and there. So there can be leakage of blood into left atrium. Rupture of chorda tendine. That could either trauma, even mitral prolapse, endocarditis can happen. We discussed about Leben-Sachs lesion. And you just remember this, acute rheumatic fever can develop mitral regurgitation. Acute rheumatic fever. This is called as Carrick-Coombs murmur. It will be associated with Carrick-Coombs murmur. This is a systolic murmur, diastolic murmur. Diastolic murmur, it is diastolic murmur. Remember that. Carrick-Coombs murmur is diastolic murmur, but it is associated with MR, it is a diastolic murmur. Acute global left ventricle dysfunction. Acute or chronic, whatever there is a. So these things apparatus is actually dependent on these papillary muscles also. Mitral valve leaflets, they depend on this. If these things are not contracting properly, this whole apparatus will not work properly. Okay. Example, this is having some problem. This papillary muscle will be misplaced, and there can be leakage because of that. Even if dilatation will open it out. Prosthetic wall dysfunction. What are the prosthetic wall? Mechanical and bioprosthetic. You read about it? Prosthetic wall, mitral wall replacement, aortic wall replacement. They can ask you on those things. There are types now, mechanical walls and bioprosthetic walls. Mechanical walls and bioprosthetic walls, now what is the difference? If the patient undergoes replacement with the mechanical wall, the anticoagulation is lifelong. If the patient undergoes mitral wall replacement with the mechanical wall, lifelong anticoagulation. If he undergoes with the bioprosthetic wall, ఇట్లా బయో ప్రొసెటిక్స్ మీన్స్ ద లైఫ్ లాంగ్ యాంటీకోగులేషన్ ఇస్ నాట్ రిక్వైర్డ్ 3 to 4 months ఆఫ్టర్ సర్జరీ టిల్ దెన్ వీ గివ్ యాంటీకోగులేషన్ దెన్ వీ కెన్ స్టాప్ ఇట్ సో ద అదర్ లైక్ బిగ్ లిస్ట్ యూ కెన్ జస్ట్ గో త్రూ దాట్ ఆస్కల్టేషన్ ఫైండింగ్స్ వాట్ ఆల్ యూ గెట్ ఇన్ దిస్ వన్ హియర్ యూ గెట్ అలౌడ్ ఆర్స్ వన్ నో యూ గెట్ డిమినిషెస్ వన్ అక్యూట్ ఎంఆర్ అండ్ క్రానిక్ సివియర్ ఎంఆర్ దెర్ ఇస్ అ then splitting of sound becomes wider. Why S2 is widely split in case of MR? It is early A2. So I told you about splitting na, that day. P2, A2 and P2. Because here, and this is a aorta, you believe that. So the blood in the ventricle is there. When it is contracting, there is a leakage into the left atrium and blood is going here. So there are dual channels of emptying. You getting it?
Yes, sir.
If there are dual channels of emptying, it will empty fast compared to the right side.
Yes, sir.
So it comes early.
Yes, sir.
Because there are dual channels, the A2 comes early. Because of that, the splitting duration will wider. But I told you that wide splitting, got it. It is usually due to delayed P2. But in this case, it is used to early A2. S3, I told you. If there is, we have discussed about S3. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
In MR, the rapid early filling. And murmur is pan-systolic murmur. What is pan-systolic murmur? Describe it.
Sir, in apex,
starts with loud at the head and goes up to
radiating to the left axillus.
What? The murmur, see, murmur of mitral regurgitation will go into the axilla. The pan-systolic murmur can be heard even with the VSD. Okay? Pan-systolic murmur starts with first heart sound, goes up to second heart sound. Okay. If it crosses the second heart sound, goes into diastole, then what it is called? If a murmur is starting, maybe it may start. If it a murmur starting in systole, crossing second heart sound and going into second heart, into diastole, what it is called? May not start with this one. It can start anywhere here. What is continuous murmur? We'll ask you on this question, sir. Continuous murmur means it is like this. It can go like this. Variable time. Okay. Okay. Starting in systole, going to diastole. Engulfing second heart sound. Okay. That is about the pan-systolic murmur and all that. Hold on a second. So, what doubts you have till now? What doubts you have?